Hallelujah. So you heard there about us having to wear masks and everything. Now, we're not wearing masks, we're behind this plastic screen. So as long as you're like one side of the screen and we're the other side of it, then we're sort of safe to go. So we don't need to wear a mask. It's only if I come outside of here, I need to put my mask on. So that's just kind of the idea. It just keeps the rules, keeps the rules. Hallelujah. But we're here to worship God, aren't we? We're here to meet with Him. That's why we came here in the first place. And despite these restrictions, despite these things that are happening around us, we can still praise Him. We can still sing to Him. We can still shout. We can still lift up our voices. And we can still give Him glory. And that's what we're made for in the first place. And that's why we have this church fellowship. And that's why we're here gathered this morning. So let's stand together. Let's all stand together as we start the service. And I'll read a psalm and we'll start. This psalm is psalm number 96. It says, "Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord. Bless His name. Proclaim His good news of His salvation from day to day. Declare His glory among the nations and His wonders among the peoples. For the Lord is great and greatly to be praised." You know, there's a great encouragement there for us to declare things and to encourage one another. I'm encouraged that you're here. And I trust that you're encouraged that we're here as well. So let's start. Let's sing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." Hallelujah.
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, heavenly, by the glory of His name, Christ.
to you this morning, Jesus.
So a verse that we have for our prayer time this morning is just from Psalm 67, verse 3 and 4. It says, "Let the people praise you, O God. Let all the people praise you. Oh, let the nations be glad and sing for joy. But you shall judge the people righteously and govern the nations on earth." And it's just, you know, the psalm at the beginning of the service is about praising God. And in Uganda, the schools are opening on the 12th of October, so I thought we should pray for them. And also, the churches have been shut since March, and they're just starting to open. Patrick and Felicity's opened last week, and Joseph Katiba, who we know has been and preached in this church, stood in St. Anne's Square with us. His church is opening today, and I know what kind of an effort it is to get a church open. And Patrick and Felicity, with the schools, they've got four schools, junior and high schools, to open up. Must be a massive job over there, getting all the PPE stuff. So let's just pray for them now. And it's just wonderful that they today will be able to gather in the churches and praise God. Amen. Just like we're doing today. Thank you, Lord. So Lord, we just pray for Patrick and Felicity and their son Herbert, who will be preparing to reopen their schools on the 12th of October. We just pray that that will go ahead. There'll be nothing that will hinder them, Lord. And we just pray for Joseph Katiba and all the churches that are reopening in Uganda, Lord, and probably across the world. We just pray that nothing will stop them from reopening, Lord. There'll be no last-minute government guidelines or anything that will come in, Lord. That they'll be able to come together and they'll be able to praise and worship you and lift your name up high.
Yes.
And that they may be encouraged and their hearts may be glad through that. And I also thought just about Clive. He's been out there since February. He's not been able to get back. He's not worried about that. He's quite happy to be in Uganda. But it's time's marching on. He's been there, 9 months now or so. So Lord, we just pray for Clive that you will be with him. That you just open up doors for him while he's there, Lord. And that you help him and guide him and protect him while he's there. In Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Well, good morning, everyone. As you can see, we've got a slightly different format to the service this morning. Normally, we have a longer time of praise and worship. But today, for the reasons that the Lord has brought, the nature of the word this morning and the preaching is to do with the power of praise. And the theme of this, the title of this word is Praise Opens Prison Doors. Praise Opens Prison Doors. And I've been really excited about this word for ages. I've had it for a couple of weeks now, meditating on it. And I believe God's going to do amazing things this morning. I really do. I just want you to close your eyes for a minute. We pray and prepare for this message from God. Lord, I thank you that your word says you watch over your word to perform it. So, Lord, if you have a word, if you have a message for us this morning, you don't just want to speak it, you want to do it. You want to act it out. You want to make it a reality. What is our part? Our part is that we open our spiritual ears, that we hear your word, and we believe that word. We believe that if God says it, God will do it. If God says it, it's the truth. I want you to repeat after me. If God says it, God will do it. If God says it, it's the truth. If God says it, I believe it, and I receive it. In Jesus' name. Amen. Right, hallelujah. So we're going to make a start in a moment. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. We have, as you all know, been given some more government guidelines recently that seem to be stricter than before. There are guidelines that are now becoming laws, and we're not able to meet in each other's houses if we're in different households or even in their gardens, and we can't do this and we can't do that and we can't do this, and then, well, Merseyside can't do other things and Northumberland can't do other things, and there's an awful lot of confusion. But mostly there's an awful lot of unrest and anxiety that is still real, that is still rife in our country, in our nation. And a word that has been used time and time again, really from the beginning, but still recently, is the word lockdown. Partial lockdown, areas in lockdown, communities in lockdown. And this word keeps coming. Well, I looked up this word in the dictionary, and I thought, let's just see what that actually means. And in the dictionary definition, lockdown is a prison term. It refers to a situation in a prison where there's been danger or a riot, and the prisoners are confined to their cells. They are on lockdown. It's a term that talks about being imprisoned or being confined. A term that means a person's freedom is taken away from them and they're in a place of confinement. And we know the reasons why lockdown is being used. We understand and we agree with it, that so that we don't get the threat of the virus coming back to us. Nevertheless, the increase in guidelines, the laws that are being brought out with £1,000 fines if they're actually broken, the culture and society we're in is massively influenced by that. And the nature of a prison or lockdown isn't to do with a physical place. So in the Bible, the Israelites were slaves in Egypt. They didn't live in physical prisons, but they were prisoners because they were made captive, they were confined, and they had no freedom. You and I, before we were saved, were prisoners. We didn't live in a physical prison, but our lives were controlled and influenced by sin and self and the devil. And we didn't have freedom or choice. We were confined within those sin boundaries. And certainly in recent 8-9 months, we've been living in the physical situation of confinement. We've been living in places where our freedom and choice to be able to mix, have fellowship, be able to visit people, be able to go places, be able to gather together, all those have been confined, and we aren't free to do that. Now, the problem with a prison and the problem with confinement or lockdown is what it does is it shrinks our world, which used to be involved with people and family and visits and parties and places and etc., all of that. And it shrinks our world smaller and smaller till it becomes maybe the house that I live in, maybe the one person I can speak to or have a coffee with it. Not only does it shrink our world, it shrinks our vision, so that if we're looking to what's possible, if we're looking and our viewpoint shrinks with that because we're not able to do things. Not only does it do that, it shrinks our impact and our influence because we're not able to be with people, we're not able to connect with people, we're not able to gather with people, we can't do outreach in the square with singing, etc. So our impact and our influence is also shrinking. It's lessened. It grows smaller. And in the world that we live in today, people are simply saying, this is the world I'm in, I've just got to work with it. The body of Christ, different. How does the body of Christ respond to lockdown? How do we respond to being confined, being put in a kind of emotional prison? So the Lord led me to a great portion of scripture that talks about someone who's put in prison. That's Paul and Silas. And we're going to read those verses and just pull out some fantastic, amazing truths that God has for us this morning. And we're actually reading from Acts chapter 16, verse 16 to 33. And I'm going to read from the New King James Version. It should be on the screen for you, but we'll have a look at that now. Now it happened, as we went to prayer, a certain slave girl, possessed with a spirit of divination, met us. This is Paul, who's on mission in Philippi. She met us, who brought her masters much profit by fortune telling. And the girl followed Paul and us, and cried out, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God, who proclaim to us the way of salvation. She did this for many days, And Paul, greatly annoyed, turned and said to the spirit, I command you in the name of Jesus Christ, come out of her. And he came out that very hour. But when her masters saw that their hope of profit was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace to the authorities. And then they brought them to the magistrates and said, these men being Jews exceedingly trouble our city. And they teach customs which are not lawful for us, being Romans, to receive or observe. And then the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrates tore off their clothes, commanded them to be beaten with rods. And when they had laid many stripes on them, they threw them into prison. There's the prison. Commanding the jailer to keep them securely. And having received such a charge, the jailer put them into the inner prison and fastened their feet in the stocks. Verse 25, but this is Paul and Silas's response to prison. But at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly, there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken. And immediately, all the prison doors were opened, and everyone's chains were loosed or fell off. And the keeper of the prison, awaking from sleep and seeing the prison doors open, supposing the prisoners had fled, drew his sword and was about to kill himself. But Paul called out with a loud voice, saying, don't do yourself no harm, for we are all here. And he called for a light. And the man ran and fell down trembling before Paul and Silas. And he brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? Isn't that a great question? Wouldn't it be good for someone to walk up to the street to you and say, sir, madam, what must I do to be saved? So they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved, you and your household. And then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in his house. And he took them the same hour of the night and washed their stripes. And immediately he and his family were baptized. Paul and Silas are preaching. There's opposition to their preaching and their mission. And they are hit. They are given many stripes, whipped really badly, punished really badly. And then they are thrown into prison. That's where they are. That's their place of confinement. And we find ourselves in a place of confinement. How do they respond as Christians to that situation? Just going to show you some steps here and look at what they did. First of all, it says here in verse 23, it says they were beaten, put in an inner prison, chained up, put their feet in stocks. They were in a really bad state. Okay. And in verse 25, it says at midnight, they began to pray and sing praises unto God. Now, what Paul and Silas did, when they had been whipped and the blood was still fresh on their backs, when they were in huge pain, when they were in confinement, when they were in that inner prison, they prayed and they praised. Their response to confinement could have been, as many other people would have done, it could have been being sad about it, complaining about it, sharing about it, asking for prayer about it. But they did not do that. In the place of confinement, it says they prayed and they praised. And they prayed and praised at midnight. Now, I want to show you something here, that praise is a choice. It's not how we feel. Okay, because Paul and Silas, I really don't think they felt like praising, do you? They were in huge pain. There was blood all over the place. They were confined. They were chained. Their feet were in stocks. And it was midnight. They were not feeling really up for praise. They weren't feeling light and happy. Their praise was not an expression of their emotion. It was a choice they made. And we are given from God in a way, not just an exhortation, but a command to rejoice in the Lord always and choose to praise him. Because if praise is just an expression of how I feel, we're not going to praise very often at the moment because this virus is catching everyone and causing such anxiety. So at midnight, they praised. It says they prayed and praised. And I love this because what happened was The word that is used in the Greek there for singing or praising is hymneo, which actually means to sing loud praise. Now, they were loud in that prison. They were not saying, oh God, help us. We are in such pain. They were singing, praise my soul, the King of heaven. They were loud. The word says here very clear. We actually know they were loud because they were in an inner prison and the other prisoners heard them. Now, in a prison, you have walls between the cells. Is that right? So you've got to sing pretty loud if the other prisoners in your prison can hear your singing. So let me be clear on this. They were not humming the tunes. They were not praying quietly. They were going for it. And it was entirely inappropriate for them to do that. It was inappropriate because they were in real pain, they were chained up, and they were in an awful place. It was also inappropriate because there were other prisoners in the same prison. It was 12 o'clock at night, and they would want to sleep, don't you think? If you were stuck in that prison, and you hear these people, praise my soul, you'd probably say, shut up. I'm tired. You see, their timing, their physical situation, and even their relationship with the other prisoners made it surely inappropriate for them to praise, yet they did it. Guidelines suggest it is inappropriate for Christians to praise or even sing or raise their voice in church or outside or in other places. But let me tell you this, Paul and Silas did it, inappropriate as it was. They got loud and lively in that prison. They got rowdy in that prison. And I want to share this with you. I think the church needs to get loud and lively. I think we need to get rowdy in the church. I think we need to do what Paul and Silas did. And what they did was they praised, listen, with power and passion. They prayed with power and passion. And we will see the results of that praise and prayer in a moment now. What we are not supposed to be doing as the body of Christ is sitting silent, passive, unrelated, unconnected, just about surviving and making it through. We don't work like that. That's not what the body of Christ does in lockdown. What the body of Christ does is it praises and prays with power and passion. Are you with me? Because no one else in the world is going to do this. And something's going to move. And in the spiritual realm, you will see in a moment the power of praise and prayer. When it's done with passion and anointing. When it's serious. It's inappropriate at the moment to get rowdy and loud and lively. Guys, that's the only thing we've got to do to break the stronghold of fear that is over our nation and our towns and our streets. Inappropriate it may be, vital it is. Are you with me? Inappropriate it may be, vital it is. For those of you who are watching this at home, it may feel inappropriate in your front room or your where it is, your dining room, to be loud and lively. But you need to get loud and lively in your own home. We need to get loud and lively. We need to get rowdy in our homes, in our churches, in our workplaces, in our streets, wherever it is. We need to get loud and lively. Turn to your person and say, get loud and lively. Get loud and lively. All right. That's what they did. That's what they did. Let's look now at the incredible consequences and results of that praise. As you know, this is about praise, clearly, so we're going to do some praising after this word this morning. So, it says, at midnight they prayed and sang praises to God. Verse 26 says, there was a great earthquake. In fact, let me read it to you here. Okay. There it goes. It says, there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken. Immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's chains were loosed. And by the way, the jailer gets saved with the rest of his family. There are four things that happen when Paul and Silas praise with passion and power. Number one, it says there was a great earthquake. Number two, it says the foundations of the prison were shaken. Number three, it says the prison doors were all fell open. And number four, it says the chains on all the prisoners fell off. That's the results of praise and prayer with passion and power. I want to show you actually what that means in the spiritual realm. Earthquake, foundation shaken, doors open, chains fall off. But let me show you a mirror image, a parallel verse of scripture that brings the same truth a little bit earlier in one of the Gospels. And if we look at Matthew's Gospel, chapter 27, verse 50 to 53, we'll see about another earthquake. Then we'll come through to where we want to be today. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 27, and I'm reading verse 50 to 53. It says this. Jesus cried out in a loud voice on the cross, yielded up his spirit. The veil of the temple was torn in two. And here we go, look. The earth quaked, number one. The rocks were split, that's foundations, number two. The graves were open, number three, that's the doorways of the prison. And the saints who were dead were raised to life, that's the chains fell off. That's the same four principles in a spiritual sense. When Jesus breathed his last, there was an earthquake. Man, the rocks were split, the graves were opened, and the people rose up in life. Those four principles are exactly the same in the Acts of the Apostles as they are in Matthew's Gospel when Jesus died. Because when the saints pray and praise in power, then the life of God is released like an earthquake. Do you believe that this morning? That's the spiritual truth. So let's have a look at that just for a couple of minutes here and see what does that actually mean for us. I love this. I preached this just before Easter on the earthquake. You see, an earthquake begins miles below the earth's crust where the two tectonic plates rub together and it causes a fissure. It causes a huge explosion. Almost in the foundations, below the earth's crust. That explosion, that gap, that fissure releases a massive seismic wave of incredible power and violence that shoots up. It splits the rocks and the earth's strata coming from way below there. It splits, it cracks, it breaks open the earth's strata and then it crashes onto the surface and causes a massive quake, a gap, a fissure in the surface of the world. But it starts at the foundations of the world, if you like. Now, spiritually, when Paul and Silas praise and pray, when they get loud and lively and rowdy and they employ power and passion in their praise, guess what happens? There is an earthquake. The earthquake is not in the physical foundations of this world. It's in hell itself. Because praise and prayer causes an earthquake to explode in the war room of hell so that the plans and purposes of the devil and all the demons are shaken and the power of hell is pushed aside. A greater power is released. It's the power of God himself. And so the plans and purposes of hell, I've written down here, they are broken by the power of prayer and praise. Now watch this. So that plan of the devil is broken. Then that spiritual huge wave of power rises up from hell. And then it says, we had an earthquake and Jesus breathed his last. So the same thing, the power of hell and sin is broken over the whole human race. Watch this. That seismic wave, that wave of power that comes from God through the Holy Spirit rises up and it says the foundations of the prison, that they were in were shaken. Now watch this. This is so important. You see, when we're in a prison, what we usually pray for, God, release me. Help me. Get me out of here. No, no, no. They don't live in a prison in that sense. That's prayer that comes from a cell. Take me out of my cell. But watch this. A prison is where a community of people live. They're called prisoners. It's not just you and I. That prison that Paul and Silas were in maybe had another 10 or 100 or 500 prisoners in it, in their cells. And watch this, that prison is a community. It's not just me. It's not just my family. It's the community where I live. Now, I want you to see the spiritual significance and power of prayer and praise. It says the foundations of that prison were shaken. That means the stronghold that has got hold of our community, our town of St. Anne's, the very foundations are shaken by the power of praise and prayer. And what are those foundations? What is that stronghold spiritually? It's a spirit of fear. That's what it is. And the spirit of fear and its grip on not just you and I, but on our town is shaken. Can you see this? You see, the angel didn't come, the Lord didn't come, the devil, the Spirit of God didn't come and take them out of the prison. It affected the whole community. Our praise and our prayer in the church, loud and lively, rowdy, passionate and powerful, does not just affect us. It affects our town. It affects our community. Can you see this? No, you can't. None of you can see this here, actually. Listen. No, no, yeah. Put your hand up if you can't see this. Okay. It's the foundations of the whole prison that were shaken. Hallelujah. In the Matthew account, it says, the rocks were split. Third point. The doors of every cell in that prison were opened. You see, this wasn't just about Paul and Silas at all. It's about the whole community. It was about the whole community. Every prisoner in that place was affected by the prayer and praise of Paul and Silas. An earthquake began and broke open and destroyed the plans of hell. It came up and shook that spirit of fear, that stronghold of that very prison. And then what it did, it caused the doors to fly open. Now, what does that mean in the spirit? Well, doors are the place of confinement. Now, we may still be in chains, but they're a place of confinement. The way is barred. When a door opens, there is a way set before us. We can see a way out of our cell. There is an exit point. There is a direction we can take. That is called hope in the Bible. Hope sees a way ahead. Hope sees a way through. Hope sees a direction. So I want you to see this. That the praise and the prayer of the church in power and with passion that is rowdy and lively and loud causes an earthquake that breaks the plans of hell, that shakes the grip of a spirit of fear over our town, and that brings hope to individuals in the town, every one of them. And don't we need hope at the moment? And then the fourth thing, oh, of course, in Matthew's scripture there, it says the graves were opened. The way is made open. And then the final thing, the chains of every prisoner fell off. And that, what a change, they're to do with our personal confinement, our personal prisons, our personal problems. Maybe it's sickness, maybe it's lack of hope, maybe it's unforgiveness, maybe it's repression or oppression. But that every single prisoner who was personally chained, those chains fell off. That's called deliverance and rescue. Are you with me? Can you see this? You see what praise does? Praise isn't just about me glorifying God. Yes, it is. But praise from God's people releases the power of God that will break the plans of hell, that will shake the strongholds over an area, that will bring hope to the people in that area, and that will bring them personal deliverance. That's why we need to praise. Amen? Praise isn't get rowdy so I feel better at the end of the service. We've actually got a privilege and a responsibility. The body of Christ, the church of God, has got the power in Jesus to break the stronghold of the spirit of fear over their community, to bring hope into their community, and for God to bring through his spirit personal deliverance, healing and rescue in their community. Our prayer is important. Well, don't you think so? This isn't just about you and me. This is about, I've lived in this town of St. Anne's for, how long have you lived here, Tess? 30 odd years. This is my town. So I'm not just interested in me and mine, or my family, or just you and me, or my church. I want my town to be free. I want to see a change in my town, and indeed my nation. When we're in the place of confinement, what do? We don't moan. When did you last moan about the virus? When did you last share with someone on the phone or text about what I can't do and what you can't do? When did you last feel like praising? Oh, ages ago. But we choose. It's a prayer of proclamation of the Lordship of Jesus. But it is praise. It's humneo. It's loud and lively praise. What does it do? Breaks the plans of hell. Shakes the stronghold of the enemy. Opens the doors into hope. And bring healing and deliverance. Now, I want that for me, but tell you what, I want it for my community, do you? And there's no one else going to be doing this in their community but the body of Christ. So what I want to share with you, and finally, because we're going to do some loud and lively praising, guys. That's why we saved it till after the word, all right? Understand the power of what gets released when God's people pray and praise with faith and power. And of course, at the end of that, while not going into it because of time, at the end of that, we find that the jailer himself, who's scared stiff, says, what must I do to be saved? He gets saved and his family gets saved. So actually, a little bit further down, we're going to see salvations in our community. Isn't that good news? Where does that begin? Prayer and praise. That's where it begins. Prayer and praise. This is probably one of the most powerful weapons we have as the Church of God. We might not be able to do party political broadcasts to the community and say, our church is praying for you. We might not be able to knock on doors or visit each other or visit them home to home, but we can praise. Can you praise this morning? I'm not asking you if you feel like it. Will you choose to praise this morning? Will you choose to believe that your praise and my praise together with power and passion is going to release a seismic wave that will have an effect on hell, that will have an effect on our community, that will have an effect on individuals and set them free? Do you believe that today? Because God said it and proved it in the Word of God. So, hallelujah. Does that sound good? Wave to him if that sounds good this morning. Great. All right, that's good. That's good. Your hands look great. Can't see your mouths. Your hands look fantastic. All right. So, this is what we're going to do. We're going to now have a time of praise. We'll have two praise songs, and then we're going to go into worship. Now, this is, watch this. As we praise, that earthquake will begin. Power of hell, stronghold. As we worship, your chains will be taken off you. So, if you need healing this morning, we're not having prayer at the front. You'll get it as we worship. If you need deliverance this morning, if you need hope, if you need refreshing, if you need anointing, if you need grace, don't ask for prayer. Worship and praise with all you've got and God will give it you because the chains will fall off. Do you believe that? Yes. Hallelujah. Let's stand.
Let's stand to our feet. And we're doing bread. Now this song is an old song, this. And I came across this song again about 2 weeks ago, and I have been singing it ever since. And if you look at the words, it says, your mercy taught us how to dance. Trish, you love this one. Your mercy taught us how to dance because of his mercy, to celebrate with all we have. And I will dance to thank you for mercy. Your glory taught us how to shout, to lift your name in all the earth. I will shout to the praise of your glory. Hallelujah. We'll be a dancing generation. We'll be a shouting generation. So, guys, I need you to get loud and lively this morning. I need you to get rowdy today in church, okay? And we need to praise God. So just raise your hands, first of all, now. And just thank God. Stop thanking God for his greatness and his goodness in this place. Stop praising him this morning. Let's
Amen.
still in his presence. Let that healing and deliverance come.
Service. I hope it's been good for you. It's been good for the Lord, I'm sure, good for all of us.
Let's remember the weapon that we have in our praise. We're going to finish the service now. We need to leave. If we need out from the back, don't forget to sanitize. And please don't congregate at the entrance. Keep your social distancing. Have a wonderful, wonderful week. We're going to see you hopefully next Sunday. And let's see the great things that the Lord's doing. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And we're going to sing you out as you leave with a dancing generation.